each.
Coming up tonight, we'll be revealing classified intelligence within the National Security Agency. Plus, this free tool will make your clipboard a whole lot smarter. And a keyboard for your PDA that materializes from thin air. Live from the TechTV studios in San Francisco, it's the Screensavers!
Good evening and welcome to the Screensavers. I'm Patrick Norton.
And I'm Kevin Rose. Thanks for joining us on TSS. All this week, we are going to Washington, D.C. We'll be taking you inside the FCC labs and the National Archives.
Plus the NSA.
Yes, that's what you're doing today.
It's really cool. I got a chance to go inside the National Security Agency for the first time. Well, actually, we were the first crew to ever go in there since 9/11.
So they wouldn't let me in.
You were actually doing some other cool
stuff.
Right.
I did have some cool stuff.
I got the DEFCON t-shirt in there, though.
Yeah, I saw that. So you went in the NSA with a DEFCON shirt on. That's not
I did have a buttoned-up shirt over it, so it was kind of stealth.
Nice.
Good stuff. Sara, you have some very cool stuff for us today.
Yeah, today, actually, everybody who likes the Control-C, Control-V copy and pasting thing, I mean, it's kind of my life.
Right.
I've got a free tool that makes it so much more useful. You're just going to have to wait and see how useful.
We're
copy and pasting.
Super copy.
That's right. Speaking of super copy, Dan?
Super copy. That's me.
Dan Fu, super copy Huard. Your name gets longer.
I'm back from the lake, man. Made it back.
Okay,
Dan. Big birthday weekend. I don't know. Nobody knew.
So you went on a vacation this weekend.
I did.
It involved a lake.
A lake.
Now everybody at home is playing the same game as the rest of us.
For sure. That's true. But anyways, give me a call. The phone number is 888-989-7879. You can also email us at thescreensavers@techtv.com. Now you know my whole life story. Back to you guys.
I wanted to go. It sounded like a lot of fun. He went up to the lake. They took a boat out. I couldn't go. I had to go visit my
family. He got bit by a squirrel.
Yeah, he did. He got a couple bite marks.
I did.
I don't know what happened there.
Nothing.
Let's start off with the tech news that caught our eye today. Sara has the first story.
Dan and the squirrels. Out of control. Okay, according to an independent filtering firm, a whopping two-thirds of all email traffic that was sent in April was spam. And if you're anything like the Federal Trade Commission, then you know that a large portion of it was sexual in nature. As part of the federal canned spam legislation that went into effect in January, all spam that includes sexual content must include the subject line sexually explicit. In addition to that, readers actually need to scroll down through the email in order to view the sexually explicit material. Obviously a good thing if you've got kids who are looking through email. Now the FTC notes that penalties for violations of this rule can result into a $250,000 fine for individuals and up to a $500,000 for an organization, as well as possible imprisonment. It's not a light thing they're taking. The FTC wants to hear about spammers that don't follow the rules, and I encourage it as well. So if you receive any naughty email, report it on their website, ftc.gov. I really think people should be taking advantage of this.
This appears to be working, actually, to some extent. I have my Gmail account, and automatically filters stuff into the spam folder. And it turns out that out of the porn-related spam, not that I go through my porn-related spam, but out of the porn-related
spam... Were you to be accosted by porn-related spam?
It seems that about, I would say about a third of it has that subject header now.
Sexually explicit.
Right. And that makes it a lot easier for anybody, even if they don't have spam filtering software, to add a filter in there, add something like built into Outlook or Outlook Express that catches any email with the subject line and automatically put it into your spam box.
Which is nice, because there's nothing worse than you fire up your first cup of coffee in the morning, you got your notebook up, you fire up your email account, and the next thing you see is a donkey. And it's just like not doing donkey-like activities. This is no way to start the day. It's even worse if you have children. It's not something you should have to see. If you want to find it
on
the web,
that thing.
Google for it. For the rest of us, don't need to see it if we don't want it.
Yoshi loves it.
I like the $500,250,000 fines, though.
That's a lot of money.
I think that a good, healthy prison sentence is definitely the way to
go. Now, there was somebody that they cracked down on here a while ago, we reported, right?
They got a group of spammers actually outside of the Detroit area, and it's actually the first two arrests and two people were charged, but I don't know if they've caught them yet, with essentially violating the Trade Commission Act. It was nuts. They were selling, like, fake dietary supplements.
Right.
And
that's terrible.
It's bad.
Bad stuff.
Sarah?
But good news.
A donkey email, not doing donkey activities. That's not something I want to see. Don't forward that to me. Coming to a cell phone near you, an RIAA lawsuit. And a donkey, also. There's no lawsuit yet, but there are some feathers ruffled over Zingtone software that allows you to convert your digital music files into ringtones. Those digital files that make your phone sing are, of course, big money, bringing in over $3 billion worldwide. So the recording companies are likely to fight you creating your own for free. If a lawsuit does arise, they'll have to fight copyright laws that permit fair use of copyrighted material that allows for 30 seconds of recording. We make use of that on the show sometimes.
Yeah, I was going to say.
There is some leeway here.
So now, is it 30 seconds that we can legally use? Or no, it's like 10 seconds that we can legally
use. Well, there's a fair use policy, so it's kind of, it's a gray area. What do you think, Patrick?
I don't know. It seems it's going to be interesting. It's like record labels are demanding mobile operators and other ring. This is from the news.com article we got this from. Other ringtone operators pay a royalty of 25 to 55% of the retail price for a sample ringtone.
Right.
They say right now they're mostly, you know, the beep, 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 beep kind of ones. They're going to be digital music samples on more and more phones in the future, which is going to make, like, traveling on a bus is going to stink. You know what I mean? When somebody starts, their phone's going to go off. They're going to be howling like Night Ranger or something.
The worst is has to be Sprint, though, out of all the cell phone providers, because you can download the ringtones and they charge you, you know, a couple dollars, but then they expire on you.
Right, after 6 weeks or 90 days.
Yeah, you get like 90 days and then you have to buy them again.
For like another $5.
Man.
I mean, it's amazing. They're saying between, you know, more than five, this is expected to be it's a $3 billion industry last year. It's expected to be a $5 billion a year industry by 2007 for ringtones. Feed children in Africa.
I know. You'd think like the built-in ones are good enough, but I guess not.
Oh, man. It's going to be interesting to see what happens.
Now, you have Notorious B.I.G. on your cell phone, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Just
Thug Life. That's me.
That's right. Thanks for the news, Sarah.
You're welcome. You, just a side note, you want to know which one Jessica has on her phone? It rang in the makeup room the other day.
What's that?
My milkshake brings all the boys to the yard, and they're like...
Does it actually sing it?
Oh, yeah. It's the song. It's great. It's very funny. You always know when it's your phone.
I got to find some Hank Williams.
I like the good old Nokia ringtone. It's like an old school. Joe joins us on the phone from Heath, Ohio.
Joe, do you have any ringtone issues?
Not really.
What's your favorite ringtone you've ever heard anywhere? We've stumped
Joe. I can't think of any offhand.
Yoshi's got the ones that's really scary. It's like a bunch of monkeys getting into a fight with each other. So, like, you'll hear the sound of, like, squalling, fighting monkeys come from Yoshi's lap, and then he'll, like, whip out his cell phone. It's really scary. Can you play it for us?
Yoshi's got it.
His cell phone's like,
He's all excited now. He gets to show off his new ringtone.
It's the most amazing ringtone ever.
Yoshi? Back to Joe's question. Joe, how can we help you?
The question I had is, with how all these online music stores are becoming more and more popular, what's going to happen if one of them goes under and you've got all this music you bought?
That's a great question.
This is an awesome question, right? Because they're all tied to digital rights management, which are tied to the whatever media system, whether you're using iTunes or whether you use the Windows Media Player. It's, you know what? Nobody knows, Joe. Okay, I guarantee you, one of these systems has to go out of business, right? Because there's been like, there's Walmart, there's Coca-Cola,
iMusic,
Microsoft
Napster.
Starting up with one, Napster 2.0, Rhapsody, Music Match. I mean, it's like
yeah, there's a ton of them.
On one hand,
Auto Parts has one now.
Yeah, maybe.
I'm just kidding.
You never know though. Like Coca-Cola has one. Who knew, right? But, you know, in theory, like, maybe they all get their music secretly from the same bank of servers somewhere in, like, North, you know, Dakota or something. But the truth is that they're all spending a lot of money. They're all trying to sell you songs. I can't believe that they're all going to stay in business.
Right. So Joe has basically two options. One is to burn it back to a CD so it strips the DRM out of the songs, and then you could re-rip it, saying that they went out of business. And the second one is hope that, and this very well could happen, is that another company would acquire their subscribers.
And that's what I think is going to happen.
I think that's what's going to happen in case. They'll probably provide some type of migration tool that you'll install. It'll then update all of your files to be the new DRM of that.
Hopefully they'll have relatively the same library so that you don't lose the rights. Because, you know, if you're at the one company that has rights to some particular selection or artist selection of music, and if that company goes out of business, we hope somebody will buy the rights. Otherwise, you know what? I mean, figure out how you can back it up. Figure out if you can back it up to a, you know, a hard drive. Figure out if the keys have to be updated on a regular basis or if they get unlocked once. Read all the fine print. This is a good time to start, like, calling tech support and looking at fine print, Joe, just to see what people say.
Joe, who do you use, just out of curiosity?
iTunes.
iTunes? Hopefully. I think you're pretty safe. I mean, they're the leader right now.
The leader right now, but, you know, I can think of a lot of computer companies that were the leader back in 77,
like
85,
and But they're still around.
They're still around.
That's true.
But, yeah, hopefully they'll be okay, Joe, but it's going to be interesting because the music companies, they're going to renegotiate their prices, and who knows what it's going to do to some of the retail sales
online. Very true. Thanks for the call, Joe, though. Great question. And for being a NetCam caller, you get a nice Screensavers t-shirt.
Which we may even hold up right today.
Mm-hmm.
Nope. Yep,
there we go. We're just getting started. Patrick goes behind the doors of the NSA, the National Security Agency, and after the break, throw away your clunky keyboard. We have a cool virtual one for you when the Screensavers continues.
G4 Tech TV, coming May 28th. Stay connected.
Welcome to the Digital Animation and Visual Effects School. Welcome to the Dave School. Located on the back lot of Universal Studios Orlando, the Dave School offers an intensive one-year degree program in computer animation. Whether it's a stampeding T-Rex or an alien invasion, computers are pushing the boundaries of imagination. At the Dave School, you'll master this new technology to begin your career in computer animation. To get your free DVD, visit daveschool.com. Our next class begins July 5th.
At CDW, account managers help you choose the IT products right for you. So we read a lot of product manuals.
Open.
They're great. My husband likes spy novels, but give me a modular access router manual any day. Then Mama Bear routes the frame directly to the switch port. I love the way this one ends.
For account managers who know all about the IT products you need, you can always expect more from CDW.
Imagine zooming to anywhere in a split second. Imagine 40 times mega zoom and lightning fast autofocus. Imagine what we can do together. The new 4 megapixel Dimage Z2. Another digital breakthrough from Konica Minolta.
Intriguing tales, spellbinding epics. The world's best anime is on Anime Unleashed. Weeknights at 1 a.m. Eastern, only on Tech TV.
No longer do you have to carry around a bulky manual keyboard, right? If you've got a PDA, you can learn how to enter in with a stylus, or you can use a little tiny virtual keyboard inside of the PDA.
Who wants to do that, though?
You've got a robust 20 characters per second entry. That's, or 20 characters per minute.
per second, that's pretty fast.
If you touch type, it's great, right? But something we've been seeing for a while is the iBiz virtual keyboard. I don't know if you can see that little tiny gray and silver cylinder over there. That's actually a keyboard. It's been on, like, every news show on the planet. Leo's had it on Regis. It's been all over the place. The idea is it projects a keyboard from that little red light and then senses it down here, and it'll project onto any flat surface.
So it's using an LED to put this keyboard out on the paper?
Yeah, and we've seen a lot of keyboards. I mean, here's one from Logitech. It's like a soft folding keyboard that wraps around your palm. One of your favorites is, you can see how kind of it's like the Fisher-Price My First Keyboard.
Yeah, I don't
like,
know so about that.
Children won't hurt themselves. You actually like the Logitech.
Yeah, the Logitech one's really cool. It kind of folds out.
It's shockingly robust, we might add.
There we go. Sorry about that. This thing is tiny, actually. There we go. It's a nice little fold-out keyboard.
Let's get a sense of scale on that one.
And it basically, your PDA just sits in the... I got to be careful with this thing. It sits right in here, and then you can type directly onto it.
Now, the iBiz virtual keyboard's a little old school. It basically uses a serial connection if you want to connect to something externally. It's got a selection of adapters. You can hook it up to various PDAs, Palm or Windows-based. And it's an interesting concept, right? Because let's go ahead and dim the light. Can we bring down the lights?
Look at the pretty glow. That's awesome.
So it essentially projects the image down in there. And if Kevin, let me turn it so Kevin can actually reach that. Let me turn the thing off and on again a few times. And the idea is that you actually type onto a flat surface.
That's pretty cool. So now if I just type right here, I can actually hear it clicking too.
So it gives you that nice feel. Now we've had, it basically works on and off with the notebook. We've been testing it on with a direct connection. It should work better with a PDA. But the truth is you and I were both playing around with this for like an hour earlier today. Neither one of us can get anywhere near a normal keyboard touch typing speed.
It seems to work for just a standard if you take your time and you really push down.
The old hunt and peck.
Yeah, the old hunt and peck.
The two-fingered whisk.
Yeah.
You know, the other thing is you notice like the delete keys all the way out in the corner. It's a very non-standard keyboard layout. We don't think you're ever going to be able to type very fast on it, but if you like looking really slick, if you got $100, if you don't mind if it doesn't work very well, the iBiz virtual keyboard has potential.
I was going to say, about 3-4 years from now, this is going to be really cool because it seems like they have the concept down. It's starting to work. They just need to tweak the software a little bit, maybe the device.
Yeah, probably the device a little bit. It is, it is battery powered. You get about 4 hours of battery life out of it. Mm-hmm. I wish they had a wireless version of it. I wish it was like a normal USB connection for a keyboard, which would be, a little bit nicer.
Yeah, it'd be nice.
Of course, normally you'd use a regular, for a notebook, you'd use a regular notebook keyboard.
And the USB when you hook the adapter on, that does not power the device at all, does it?
No. The USB adapter is actually a USB serial adapter.
It's a serial converter. Okay.
Interesting idea. It's $100. It's sold out right now, so it'll be interesting to see
how many
people...
It looks hot.
It's a cool idea, but this reeks of something that a lot of people are going to buy, and it's going to go immediately to the back of a drawer and stay there. Cool idea. We want to see what it looks like in the future, and we got a review up online and links to the virtual keyboard from iBiz up at thescreensavers.com.
Excellent. Now here is Sarah with a quick tip.
Or more of an announcement. The TechTV Digital Digs Roadshow is heading to a town near you. The next stop is Atlanta, Georgia. Come on out and meet Jessica Corbin, Adam Sessler, and Morgan Webb at the Lenox Square Mall on Saturday, June 5th from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Sunday, June 6th from noon till 5. Last time I told you that, I said it was this weekend, but it's actually the next weekend, so mark your calendars. And coming up next on this show, Patrick pieces together some clues as we get an unprecedented behind-the-scenes look at the National Security Agency in Washington, D.C.
G4 Tech TV, coming May 28th. Stay connected.
How's your credit? In the next 60 seconds, I'm going to show you an easy way to instantly check your own credit report for free. So the next time you need credit and apply for a home loan, car loan, or even a credit card, you won't have to imagine what your credit report looks like. You'll know. To learn how to get your free credit report instantly and online, just log on to freecreditreport.com. It's that simple. At freecreditreport.com, you can instantly see what's in your report, who put it there, who's been looking at it, so you can make sure everything's accurate. Staying on top of your credit can make it easier for you to qualify for the lowest available interest rates, which could save you a lot of money. So don't wait. Join the millions of Americans who've already logged on to freecreditreport.com. Got a minute? Just log on to freecreditreport.com. That's freecreditreport.com.
Freecreditreport.com.
Gamefly. Rent the games you want, play as long as you want, for one flat rate. No due dates, no late fees. Go to Gamefly.com for your free trial.
Feel at home. Everywhere. Introducing Infiniti's new full-size SUV, the QX56. Surround yourself with refinement, entertainment, and comfort for seven. from Infinity.
I am a soldier, an army of one. Even though I am part of the strongest army in the world, I am my own force. With the latest technology, training, and support, who I am has become better than who I was. And I'll be the first to tell you, the might of the U.S. Army doesn't lie in numbers. It lies in soldiers like me, Specialist Mark DeCarli. I am an army of one, and you can see my strength.
Day two of the Screensavers in D.C. week. Best part of the trip for me, I had a chance to go inside the NSA, the National Security Agency. It's a toss-up, as far as I'm concerned, between the NSA and DARPA for the smartest crew in federal government. It was pretty intense. We met at a remote location. We got sniffed for bombs by a giant German Shepherd. We were ferried, not in our own vehicles, to the building by an NSA police group. And then we finally got to meet the folks, get our secret safety badges, and go inside. Let's check this out.
Screensavers in Washington, ladies and gentlemen, I can't believe we're inside the building. We're here with the Director of Research, Dr. Hazeltine, at the National Security Agency. Doctor, thank you so much for taking
great
the time.
Great pleasure to be
us.
Here.
Shu, for those of us who aren't familiar with the NSA, what do you guys do here?
We have two missions. Our first mission is to collect electronic information as it moves from point A to point B outside the borders of the United States. Our other mission is to stop our adversaries from doing the same thing to us. Because our job is to invent the future of the collection and protection of electronic information for the nation, not a small responsibility.
This is for foreign intelligence only, so you don't have the most powerful computers in the world in the basement reading all of our email.
No, we don't. You know, the enemy of the state and movies like that make you think we can do lots of things that we don't do and that we can't do. I wish we could do all of the things that they said we could do. But the fact is, we do not collect information on Americans. We do not collect information inside the United States. We are strictly foreign intelligence. And the biggest problem we have is connecting the dots. There are a lot of dots out there, because our job is to collect dots, find the right dots, put them together, and turn it into actionable intelligence, which will prevent terrorist attacks. And that is a very difficult job. It requires a lot of high technology.
So you have a demo for us.
We have a demo. We're going to take you into our secret lab where we're doing all this magic. But first, you have to put your eye about 10 inches away from that eye scanner so that the computer will know who you are and let you in.
Why am I suddenly afraid?
We are sorry, you were not identified.
Oh, tough toenails, dude. You know, I was looking forward to this interview, but I'm just going to have to go in there without you. It's been nice knowing you. Thanks.
Oh, come on.
See you later.
I shouldn't have worn the DEFCON t-shirt.
So this room is going to illustrate the problem of connecting dots across many different data domains.
And I'm looking at this, I'm seeing an array of monitors. I'm thinking, are these all running on separate systems?
Right. Each one has a separate network, air-gapped from other security networks. And they're different sources of collection, different sources of repositories of data, and different types of intelligence.
You've got all these machines in a cubicle. You've got people running down hallways to get access to information. How do you bring all that together?
Well, the situation that we're going to show you by analogy is not all that unusual, where a given intelligence analyst, and we call them all source analysts because they fuse together lots of different types of information, may literally have six different PCs, six different keyboards, six different monitors, and have to shuttle back and forth and remember what they saw and write down notes in order to fuse all the information. And by analogy, what that's like is having different peaks at reality of different dots of information. And the analogy that we're going to use is looking through a knothole.
Okay.
Right? So here we're going to look through the first knothole on the first network, and you see an image or a piece of information which is kind of hard to understand.
Right.
Okay.
Could be a cloud, could be muslin, could be
a anything.
Sheet.
Exactly. Could be the inside of your eyelid on a bright day.
That would be bad.
Yes. Okay, here's another dot of information. A little bit more texture to it, but still not quite clear what it is. And here yet is another one. Starting to get a little more suggestive, but again, we don't necessarily know what it is. And then we continue on around to network number 5 and network number 6. The problem is the human brain isn't very good at remembering fragmentary pieces of information unless you have photographic memory, as it were, and merging it all together. So the way we solve that, again, by analogy, is our technology here called NetTop.
So what are you guys putting together here with NetTop?
Well, NetTop is the solution to the problem we've just been talking about. Mm-hmm. What it does is it takes all these different networks and data domains and fuses it into one place so a human can see it in one place at one time and connect the dots. And continuing the analogy, it would be like fusing all of the knot holes. You put them all together, you see a picture that you wouldn't have seen without them all being in the same place at the same time.
Got it.
The NSA has created a way, NetTop, to secure all those networks and data domains and keep the information separate and controllable, yet still, well, essentially allow them to be displayed on one system. After the break, we're going to learn a little bit more about how the NSA uses classified intelligence, or how the intelligence gathered by the NSA is actually used. We're going to talk about that when The Screensavers continues.
You're late. Big line at the toll booth. You know those electronic passes?
Yeah.
Used to be one lane, then two, now three.
And you don't have one?
No.
It's the on-demand world.
Huh?
Electronic pass connects to toll booth, connects to bank. Bank to your credit card. You come in here with your laptop, click, click, pay your bill through the air. But you don't get it, so you wait in line.
That means something.
Mr. Shatner, please have a seat. We have to let you go.
But I'm the voice of Priceline.
But now it's the new Priceline.
What's new about it?
You can actually choose your flights, times, even airlines from a selection of very low fares.
Or you can still name your own price and save even more, Rich.
But who could possibly replace me?
Hi, guys. Hey, Bill.
Hey, Leonard. The new Priceline. Now there's a choice.
Start the car.
Horsepower V6, traction control, and sliding rear seats. Chevy Malibu Max, an American revolution.
Everybody knows one, the guru of the game. That's why the Home Depot has the Skybox vending machine by Maytag to keep every fan's favorite drinks closer and colder than ever. We have one ready for you.
Just call, click, or visit your local Home Depot store today for your very own personal beverage vendor. Then start keeping up to 64 cans or 32 bottles of your favorite beverages close to the action. Customize the logo panels with your favorite team. Set the lockout to say, hands off, buddy. Get a 2-minute warning before drinks run out. Order the Sky Base that holds snacks, too, because man does not live by carbonated beverages alone. The Home Depot has your Skybox vending machine by Maytag for only $4.99. Order right now and you'll get a free $50 Home Depot gift card by mail-in rebate.
So call, click, or visit your local Home Depot store today. We have one ready for you. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Watch X Play weeknights 11 p.m., 10 p.m. Central, only on TechTV.
Welcome back to The Screensavers. I'm Patrick Norton. Coming up in this half hour, if I don't cough myself to death, learn how you can copy and paste like a pro with Sarah's latest free download, and find out what type of firewall is best for your network. Can you give up the software if you got a router? It's good stuff coming up. So far, though, you've seen Dr. Hazelstein find the knot holes of information and small fragmented pieces of information together to basically make a chunk of information. In part two of our look at the NSA in Washington, D.C., you're going to see how different types of intelligence are pieced together and decoded while remaining secure using NetTop. See the video.
So what we're going to do is we're going to walk you through a realistic scenario of the different kinds of intelligence from different networks that we might have to piece together today. Okay. So the first thing we're going to show you here is a conversation that we acquired. It just kind of fell into our lap, okay?
Got it.
And so we get a fragmentary piece of information, and here's what it says. Somebody, a civilian, is saying to another civilian, did you hear all those
Delete expletive.
Bleep. Noise going down the goat path. So something's going on in a goat path. That by itself doesn't tell you a lot.
Right.
This is what we call signals intelligence. It's what we do. It's what we call SIGINT. We collect electronic signals as they're going from point A to point B, again, outside the United States.
Right.
And it says, flash, all military radio communications stopped at this point in time in this place.
So
it's a dog that didn't bark. Curiouser. This is what we call adversary intelligence. This is information that we've gathered about bad guys from a source. And what this says is that we heard this source say to itself, hammer of steel is go, commence radio silence immediately. Well, that's interesting because we just heard radio silence.
So we know, right? The radio is silent. So something is going on.
Something's going on. Not only did we hear the dog not bark, we heard the dog's master telling the dog not to bark. And this is what we call electronic intelligence. And let's say that that has to do with emissions of a radar that might be carried by the enemy. And we get a report from collection that said a radar is active in an area. It turns out that this area, once you decode all the numbers, is kind of similar to the areas that we were just in.
So we've got silence where there was noise, we've got radio silence, we've got armor movement, we've got the hammer of the gods, we've got natives reporting some weirdness going on.
Ah, but you just said armor movement. We heard heavy noises. We don't know that that's armor. But hold that thought.
Okay.
Okay. So over here, we continue. So now, the circumstantial evidence is mounting. We're starting to get some pretty good suspicions. And to add to the evidence, we have what we call satellite intelligence. And what this is saying is that an analyst has said there's troop movement at this time in this place, and here and here.
Got it.
So we're starting to get a clearer picture of what's going on. But still, it's fragmentary information. We're having to remember one piece of information as we move on to the next. The last piece of information in the puzzle is starting to look pretty darn suggestive. You said armor?
Armor.
Turned out you guessed right. But you got to be careful in intelligence not to guess, not to let your perceptions lead you down a wrong path. It could have just as easily been a bunch of garbage trucks.
That would be bad.
So this is window number one from network number one and PC number one. Number two, number three, number four, five, and six. But one of the things I want to point out is, and you heard it here first, we're also working on technology that once we provide secure partitions between these different data domains and networks to allow you to copy and paste across them.
Based on rights and permissions?
Right. Then the next step that we're working on right now, and we have it going in our laboratory in an experimental form, is to be able to safely move data from one of these networks and domains into another so that you can merge it all into a single report and say, hey, here's a troop movement at this place and this time, and here's what kind of enemy we've got. And that's basically what the tactical commanders want to know.
Classic intelligence problem. You know, I can have the best information in the world, but if the people who need it can't get to it, it's like not having it.
Well, you know, you raise an interesting point because we make a distinction between information
and raw data.
Intelligence and knowledge, right? Intelligence is we picked up some information about a loud noise. Knowledge is that it connects in some ways with other information. Intelligence is that is an armored brigade with this designation, with this amount of capability, about ready to attack you here. Because that's what we call actionable intelligence. A commander in the field knows what to do with that information. Now, there's an adage in our business that complex problems require simple solutions. Very complex problems require very simple solutions. And here is the complex problem. By analogy, each computer program or application runs on data, which also by analogy is this colored paint that you see here.
Got it.
The problem is that an operating system or an application may be millions of lines of code, and there's no way to make sure the data that's running on that code doesn't leak where it shouldn't go.
As many of our Microsoft users in the audience are familiar with.
Well, I didn't use the M word, you did.
I know, use the M word.
All right. The other problem is that the operating system, again by analogy, which is the pan that supports all this stuff, when the stuff leaks, it allows it to mix. So two bad things happen here. We have a very simple solution. We don't try to do programs that won't leak. What we do is we put the programs in what we call a container. And the container is a virtual machine. A virtual machine is a software emulation of hardware. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if it leaks. Your container is not going to let that leak get out. We now have to patch the remaining holes in our containers. And we do that by this thing called mandatory access control. Literally what we're doing is we've worked with Linux and modified it to have what we call secure Linux. Mm-hmm. And secure Linux has mandatory access control, which says there's a traffic cop that says you can't go there. Mm-hmm. So now we are certain, and we can prove it mathematically, that information is not going to leak out of those containers. Now going back to the imagery that you saw just a while ago where we had those different windows of intelligence, each one of those is a container, a secure container. But as I said, the ultimate goal is to be able to move information across one container to another. Another term for that is connecting dots. So that's what we're showing here with this plumbing. It's called controlled sharing. And that's sophisticated technology that we use to allow information, but only the information we want to move from point A to point B to move. And because we want to just be able to buy it as off the shelf, once we developed it, we worked with both the people who do Linux and other providers to take the VMware, the secure Linux, and put it all together in this thing we call NetTop. And now NetTop can be bought off the shelf.
Is NetTop being currently deployed in various intelligence units? And is that the right phrase, intelligence units?
Intelligence units. It's the right phrase, but not the right question.
Okay, what's the right question?
Well, the right question is that we developed it to be deployed at intelligence agencies.
Got it.
But whether we have or not, I can't say.
It was extremely difficult to ask the question that Dr. Hazeltine could actually answer and share with everyone. But you know, this is pretty much the most recent technology developed from our friends at the NSA that they were willing to share with us. Interesting point. We've heard Microsoft say, and some Microsoft-supported studies say that, hey, you know what? Linux is un-American. I think if the NSA is using it to protect secure information, that's probably as anti-terrorist as a piece of software can get. Kevin, what's going on with this week's LAN party?
This LAN party, we're only 2 days away from the Screensavers LAN party, which is, of course, powered by NVIDIA. The game is Battlefield 1942, the Desert Combat Mod, version .7. It's got new maps to kill people on, new sounds to hear people die, and new weapons to kill people with. So go to our website and click on Join Our LAN Party to register for the links to download the 591 megabyte Desert Combat mod. If you have dial-up, you're probably not going to be able to play. Don't forget, you got to have the full version of Battlefield 1942. We'll see you Thursday for the Screensavers LAN Party. Now, stay where you are. Our next caller just installed a hardware firewall. He wants to know if it's okay to ditch the software one. But up next, Sara's free download is a copy and paste and machine. Learn more when the Screensavers continues.
Connected.
Oven mitts. What's with all the models?
Well, now that Arby's has introduced salads every bit as good as you get at a nice sit-down restaurant, we are attracting a whole new crowd.
True salad lovers are coming in for Arby's new Market Fresh salads with tender chicken plus really fresh, really tasty, really surprising ingredients. Try the Asian sesame, the Martha's Vineyard, and the Santa Fe.
These salads are a great idea.
Yeah, a really great idea.
Try Arby's new Market Fresh salads.
Looking for something more? Wider horizons, a fuller life? I was, and I found it surprisingly close to home. I tried Fly for just $49 at my local flight school. All it took was the free certificate from Be a Pilot. I'm getting off the road and out of the crowd.
For your certificate, call 888-BE-A-PILOT or log on to beapilot.com.
Getting started was easy and well worth it. Try it. You'll be surprised.
I kind of went into the eHarmony process thinking, I have to be myself. I have to be exactly who I am. If I'm matched with somebody who appreciates that, then I'm with the right person.
Dating services match you on a picture and a paragraph. At eHarmony.com, our compatibility matching system connects you with other singles based on 29 dimensions of compatibility.
eHarmony allowed me to place an order for the perfect man, and then they delivered the most compatible relationship I've ever had.
Go to eHarmony.com right now and get your $40 personality profile free.
Peace, y'all. We're Blackalicious.
Yahoo. Yahoo.
I use Yahoo Search to find other Republican Party animals to party with.
Hip-hop is a way to express yourself.
So that's what it's all about. Partying.
Rapping.
Republicans.
DJing.
Money.
I think the thing that's really cool about Yahoo Launch is that it makes music accessible.
And I'm taking my time to perfect the beat, and I still got love for the street.
Music engine. Search engine. Life engine.
Yahoo!
Get down!
Visual wonderlands, intriguing tales, spellbinding epics. The world's best anime is on Anime Unleashed. Weeknights at 1 a.m. Eastern, only on Tech TV.
Let's check in with the fine folks over at Fresh Gear to see what's coming up tonight. Stephanie!
Hello.
Hey!
I don't know, Patrick. That guy says he doesn't keep files on us at the NSA. I don't believe him.
You know what? We'll never know.
I don't believe him either. If he didn't have a file on you before, I have a feeling he does now.
Well, in theory, right? They only look at communications outside of the continent of the United States.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, you're about as trusting as I am. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna, you know, not upset them, Stephanie. What's on Fresh Gear tonight?
In theory. Now, when you guys get an MP3 player or a portable digital audio player, do you ever keep the earbuds that come with them?
Yeah, I use the Apple earbuds.
You do?
Yeah.
See, wow. I don't, because they never fit and they usually sound like crap.
True.
Well,
that's true.
Tonight on Fresh Gear, our team has put their ears through torture to bring you the best in-ear headphones out there.
Ooh, you got the new Atomonics.
Yes, not only do they sound good, but they are actually comfortable. We look at three of them, find out which ones we pick.
Good stuff coming up.
Yep, tonight, 8:30 Eastern.
So I always wondered about that because they have the more expensive Apple iBuds and then the ones that come with them. The more expensive ones look a little cooler. I don't know. We'll check it out. We're going to find out
when Stephanie shows you tonight. You're
going to find out.
On Fresh Gear, which is right on.
Thanks, Stephanie.
Check.
Bye.
Sorry.
No.
I was just going to read the.
Oh, okay. You go ahead.
After you.
Now it's time for Sara. She has a download of the day.
Why do you guys always have to fight about the teleprompter? No, you. No, it's me. Go ahead.
After you, Sara.
Okay. I'm a big copier and paster, you know, Control-C, Control-V, or edit, copy, edit, paste. But sometimes I want to paste what was copied to the clipboard a couple times ago, perhaps. Right? And, of course, you can't really do that because you can only paste what you just copied. Now, I have here a Word document open. In later versions of Microsoft Office, I think it's 2000 and beyond, XP, 2003, you can save multiple terms, words, paragraphs, whatever, to the clipboard, which is helpful. I have it open right now. As you can see, I have my little clipboard area on the right-hand side, and I've saved a bunch of stuff so I can copy or I can paste things that I copied a while back. That's okay, but that's only going to help you within Office, right? What if you wanted to copy and paste multiple things to Notepad or some other copying and pasting applicable program, right? That's why I love a program called Clip-O-Matic. It's running right now, and you'd never know, except that down in the right-hand corner, you see the sort of torn paper icon. That is Clip-O-Matic running. Now, I will show you what it does. It's fun. If I just say, the way that I would paste something would be Control-V, right? I'm just going to say Control-Alt-V, and now, I've got all these interesting options. What I have is numbers 1 through 6 are things that I've copied to my clipboard. This is sort of just another visual way to look at my clipboard. And now my A, B, C, and D's, these are permanent clipboard terms. These are things I always want to have on hand, no matter what's in my cache at any given moment. So that's very helpful. What I can do is just set my cursor to where I want it to be. Okay, I want it to be right down after hello. And I can either choose something with my mouse, or I can actually just say number 3, which is very helpful. Just depends on if you want to use your keystrokes or your mouse. There's a lot of other options here which make it even more fun. Let's go back to my menu here, and it popped up over on the right-hand side. And I'll go to my main menu. I'll start with the settings area. Let's say you don't want Control V, you want something else, you can change it here. Your cash items will stop at 10 unless you want to go, I believe it goes all the way up to 64 if you so desire. You can load Clip-O-Matic on startup, you can paste on select, you can designate where you want your directory to be. I personally have no problem with where they put it by default, but you have the option to change it if you want to. And if you go into, I will now show you the clip sets area. Now, clip sets are very helpful. Let's just say that you're going to create a document where you know you're going to put in a few email addresses that you use a lot. That's where you can create clip sets that you can load. It doesn't have to be what you have copied and copied to your clipboard right now. You might have done it a week ago and you've just saved it. I've got, for example, my default clip set. Let's say, oh, okay, I want to open that. And I'll go up there and you see there's different stuff on the top here, right? And let's say I want to open my fun clip set. And as you can see now, I've got seven different clipboard options. As I said before, the terms A, B, C, and D, they stay because they're my permanent clip set. Those are the stuff I always want. I never want it to go anywhere. It's good stuff. There's a lot of other things you can do with Clip-O-Matic, and I don't really have time to tell you all about it. That's why I encourage you to look at the help menu. This seemed like a really, really simple program. I actually kind of had a hard time getting it to work at first. Once I read the help menu items, which I usually never do, but once I actually did with this program, it made a lot of sense. It seems invaluable to me because it's free, easy to use, and it's a good time. You know, Control C, Control V, who knew it could be so fun? So get it for yourself in my Download of the Day article at thescreensavers.com. Where else? Am I ever going to say anything else?
Does that work out of outside of Office itself?
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's the great thing about it. It's like, yeah, you can use multiple clipboard options within Microsoft Office,
right.
But who wants to limit themselves to that? Clip-O-Matic will work with anything within
Notepad.
Windows. What's that?
Notepad,
yes, Notepad.
Really?
I thought you said Notepad. Even Notepad, people.
Wow.
And it's like from Windows 95 to XP, runs the gamut. It's a good time.
Sounds good. Works in Notepad.
Impressive.
I'm stoked. Coming up after the break, our next caller wants to know which is better, software firewalls or his new hardware one. Hmm. We'll tell him right after these messages.
G4 Tech TV, coming May 28th. Stay connected.
XM Satellite Radio. Over 100 digital channels you'll never want to be without. With 100% commercial-free music, plus news, sports, and talk for under $10 a month. XM Satellite Radio.
We see Sophie designing. Her name. Turning a crazy idea into the latest craze. We see her potential. We're inspired to create software that helps her reach it.
The new GMC Envoy XUV has so many exclusive features you've never seen before. The only way to truly experience it is to take a test drive like never before. A 24-hour test drive. Schedule a 24-hour test drive only at your participating GMC dealer and see why the new Envoy XUV is the sport utility with more utility. Professional-grade engineering. It's not more than you need, just more than you're used to.
It all starts with a chip that contains world-leading technology. Together with Samsung's superior engineering and design, it does so much more. It inspires. It enriches. It's the soul of Samsung, and it's in everything we create. Experience the power within Samsung.
Be sure to catch tomorrow's show. Who has more rights to your information, you or the feds? We're going to have a guest on to talk about that. Plus, we explore the tech behind preserving America's most treasured documents at the National Archives in Washington, D.C. Finally, we're going to show you the coolest new maps for your summer road trips. All that and so much more on tomorrow's Screensavers.
Now, Brian joins us on the phone from Morgantown, West Virginia. Hey, Brian.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good. How you doing?
Fine. I'm going to be getting DSL through Verizon, and they've been offering a free Linksys router after a rebate.
Cool.
And I've got one computer, and I'm going to have one computer for some time to come. I'm already running McAfee's firewall mm-hmm. for your suggestion, of course. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the big deal is, you know, if I'm running the software firewall, what are the advantages or disadvantages of that hardware firewall on the router?
Well, the cool thing is that you're doubling your protection,
not
basically.
Much.
Yeah. Is it a laptop or a desktop?
Desktop.
It is? Okay. See, what I do is that when I have my laptop,
right.
I have a Linksys at home as well, and I run a firewall on here just because when I'm on the road, I might mm-hmm. be in certain areas where I'm not behind a firewall, and it's a good idea to always have a software firewall running on your machine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you're at home, my home desktop machines, which I have quite a few of them, I don't run any type of software firewall. I trust
you've got the
Linksys.
Main hardware
right.
firewall on there.
Yeah.
I mean, you could take some, if you think the firewall's dogging performance, which I doubt that you would really notice anything on that, you could, you know, I can think of, like, this is like the one advantage I can think of, Brian. You're taking one piece of software off your PC and you're using a separate box to keep that security clear. But other than that, I don't think you really need it. If you don't plan on adding more computers,
right.
if you don't need a network, if you aren't going to have people over to share your network connection, if you don't want to sell your Wi-Fi to your
right.
neighbors or something like that.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Like, if you have anybody on your network
mm-hmm.
that you don't trust, it might be a good idea, because if they're inside of your network
right.
or you're using Wi-Fi and someone happens to get inside of your local network,
yeah.
it's a good idea to have a firewall on that
right.
machine. But
are you running, like, you know, an Ethernet connection to the DSL modem, which is connected to the phone jack in the wall, Brian?
It's just going to be hardwired to the router.
There's, you know, I can't think of a single advantage to go into an external box in your case.
If you're not a big gamer and you're not noticing any type of performance lags mm-hmm. and you don't mind seeing those little pop-up messages from time to time and you already own the software, not a big deal. Might as well leave it running on
right.
there. But otherwise, just take it off, save the box, throw it on another machine you might have, give it to a friend, whatever
yeah.
you want.
Well, you haven't bought the Linksys box yet, right, Brian?
No.
Okay.
I'm just considering it, since I may be adding a Linux machine just to play around with later.
Yeah.
You know, if you're
going to
have, you know, I'd rather use, like, the Linksys box than set up internet connection sharing on a Windows XP system and use that to share the network. You know, if you plan on adding additional systems, it's nice. But the truth is, the boxes
right.
are so cheap.
Right. You can always buy one later.
For $50, it's not costing you that much to go out and buy one when you actually need one. Right?
It's always nice to have one at home, though. If you have any friends or relatives mm-hmm. that are visiting that want to share your DSL
right.
connection, they can just plug right in. There, you don't have to unplug your connection. It's pretty cool. We have them at my house as well.
Ah,
yeah.
You
we also have a lot more computers probably in our house.
That's true. Thanks
Good
for the call, Brian. Now, let's check in with Leo for a quick tip.
Where did he go? There he is.
Hey, Leo.
How would you like to keep nasty spiders off your site? You know, we frequently get questions, how do I get my site to show up on Google and other search engines? But we also get questions, how do I keep my private stuff from showing up on Google and other search engines? Once pages that you want to keep to yourself show up on search engines, anybody can find them. That's where robots comes in. Robots was a standard for robot exclusion that was created in 1994. Even then, people realized there's going to be an issue with wanting to hide some stuff on the net. It allows you to create a text file, robots.txt, in the root directory of your website that well-behaved search engines, that includes Google and Yahoo and Lycos and all the good guys, will say, okay, fine, you don't want me to look there, I won't index that. So, you know, there are a lot of reasons you might want to do this. Private journals, things like that. You might want to, you know, have them ignore the temp files, because those are going to change, things like that. I'll show you, this is the link, and I've got it on my web article, to the description of a robots.txt file. It's really very simple. You just create robots.txt. There's only two values that can be in it. There's the user agent value, which says which spider, which robot, which automatic indexing agent this applies to. Use an asterisk for everybody. And then disallow, which tells them which directories to ignore. I'll show you mine. I use this in Leoville. This is my robots.txt. I disallow all user agents from my daughter's website, and I have some special work sites for friends. I don't let them in there. And then I do allow media partners from Google, which is my ad-serving engine, to search everywhere. So you see, I have nothing under disallowed. They're allowed everywhere on my site. That's all there is to it. Now, it's not a security method because anybody can look at your robots.txt site. So anybody can see which directories I'm trying to hide from search engines. Don't think of this as an access control feature. It's just a way to keep those search engines from indexing pages you don't want them to know about. All right? Robots.txt, all the details on the webpage of thescreensavers.com. And robots, you may search that. Back to you, Ben.
Good stuff.
Thanks, Leo.
Yeah.
Buy my book.
Now let's check in with Dan for a helpful tip.
Thank you, guys. If you have Office 2003, then you have a brand new Internet Explorer add-in called Research. Now, it allows you to look anything up using the Encarta Dictionary, the Encyclopedia, Thesaurus, everything. All you need to do is click right up here on top, click on Research right up there. Now, it's not populating, unfortunately. There we go. Okay, so if you look down here, I looked up Hello, and you can check all these different things, thesaurus, everything, does it all for you. But guess what? It's also available within the Office 2003 suite as well. So stay where you are. We're checking our inbox, see what's on your mind. When the Screensavers comes back.
Every piece has its purpose. The Element from Honda.
Games you want, play as long as you want, for one flat rate. No due dates, no late fees. Go to Gamefly.com for your free trial.
Everybody knows one. The guru of the game. That's why the Home Depot has the Skybox vending machine by Maytag to keep every fan's favorite drinks closer and colder than ever. We have one ready for you.
Just call, click, or visit your local Home Depot store today for your very own personal beverage vendor. Then start keeping up to 64 cans or 32 bottles of your favorite beverages close to the action. Customize the logo panels with your favorite team. Set the lockout to say, hands off, buddy. Get a 2-minute warning before drinks run out. Order the Sky Base that holds snacks, too, because man does not live by carbonated beverages alone. The Home Depot has your Skybox vending machine by Maytag for only $4.99. Order right now and you'll get a free $50 Home Depot gift card by mail-in rebate.
So call, click, or visit your local Home Depot store today. We have one ready for you. The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Watch X Play weeknights 11 p.m., 10 p.m. Central, only on TechTV.
It's that time. Sarah, do you have any final emails?
Of course. First one comes from Chris. He says, as a hardcore PC gamer, I play Far Cry, World of Warcraft, Dark Age of Camelot, EverQuest, just to name a few. And I'm staying on my computer for a long time, 60 plus hours a week. My question, is it better to leave my computer on all the time since I'm on it so often, or to turn it off after every night of sessions?
I'm probably gonna say turn it off and go outside and get some exercise. Yeah.
Definitely turn your monitor off when you're not using it.
60 hours of gaming?
That's like Brett and Tano time in video games.
You're gonna crack yourself out doing that kind of stuff. That's gonna mess with the head eventually.
What's funny is, like, this is a question we get, like, three or four times every month, and it's like the ancient computer question, should I turn my system off when I'm not using it or not? If it's down on the floor, if the cat likes to sleep next to it, if you live in a dusty environment, if you haven't vacuumed in a month, turn it off. It'll keep that much more stuff from being sucked in through the fan vents. Definitely turn your monitor off when you're not using it, or at least put it into
monitor
a safe
for
mode.
Sure.
Because you know what? Monitors, they wear out eventually. But yeah, if you're on it like 60 plus hours a week,
go outside and play for a while.
There like you go. The voice said.
Oh, whatever. You guys would be playing 60 plus hours a week if you didn't have a job.
Yeah.
Okay, fair next enough. One from Josh. He says, I'm sure this is a common question, but what's the best way to transfer files from my iPod to a hard drive for both Mac and PC?
I know that there's some
Can't
third...
Can't you just drag and drop it?
Well, you know, if you view the hidden files and go in there, they name them really funky naming conventions, and you can drag and drop them. On the Mac side of things, if you launch a terminal, if you know a little bit about Unix and how to actually change to the volumes directory...
Are you talking about the MP3 files or the actual other files?
The AACs and all the information, all the MP3s and the AACs that you have on there. It's just a mounted volume like anything else. You can browse within there and then just drag and drop the files over. The protected ones obviously are not going to play on anything but the machine that you know that you've registered with them with. So
fair play.
That's true.
That's like fair. That's it for this edition of the Screensavers. I'm Patrick Norton.
And I'm Kevin Rose. Thanks for joining us. We would like to thank our National Security Agency guest, Dr. Eric Hasseltine. See you next time and have a great night.
Good evening, everybody.